Good morning everyone. We are starting with a new topic today, which is UVR, ultraviolet radiation. As we know, UVR are the ultraviolet radiation which are invisible to the human eye. So as you can see in the electromagnetic spectrum over here, ultraviolet rays are having the wavelength between 10 nanometer till the 400 nanometer, which are again dividing in the three types. See, there are three types of ultraviolet radiation: UVA, UVB and UVC. How these types are being made? According to the wavelength and the uses of that we are using it for the therapeutic purpose. So as you can see here, UVA are having the wavelength between 400 nanometer to the 315 nanometer, while UVB is having 315 nanometer to 280, and all the rays below the 280 nanometer, still you can say 100 or 10 nanometer, are considered as UVC. Again, we can say UVA and UVB both are used for the therapeutic purpose, so known as biotic waves. And UVC are having germicidal effect, like bactericidal. They will destroy the tissue. So it is abiotic in nature, and they are usually used for the infected wounds and etc. Otherwise, they are having very dangerous effect over the body tissues. Okay, coming to the UVR generators. But before that, as we know, sun emits the UV rays. So sun emits all the types of UVA, B and C. But as we know, there is an ozone layer which absorbs the UVC, because they are having most damaging effect over the body parts. So actually from the sun, UVC are not reaching till here, because it is blocked by the atmosphere. Again, you can say if overexposure of UVA and UVB will be there, then it may lead to the cataracts, or it may cause the skin cancers that we all know. Now, for the therapeutic purpose, when you want to use the UV rays, so what all are the options that are available for us to give the treatment in terms of UVR? So there are three types of UV generators, which are basically high pressure mercury vapor lamp, you can say. Then there is a chromar lamp, and there is a fluorescent tubes. So what is the high pressure mercury vapor lamp? As you can see here, there is a U-shaped tube which is actually made up of quartz, inside which there is a presence of argon gas, inert gas, at the low pressure, along with the some amount of mercury. At the end of the tube, you can see the electrodes which are connected with the mains, and over which there is a metal cap. Now, what happens when we start applying the current? As we know, argon is an inert gas, so it gets ionized. Meaning one electrode from the outer shell of it will get stripped out, and the atom will be losing its negative particle. So the remaining atom will become positive. Now this electron will go to the positive terminal of the electrode, and the remaining atom will move towards the negative terminal of the electrode. Now, as and when this ionization process starts, the more amount of electrons will move towards positive pole, and the remaining atom, which is positive, will move towards the negative pole. All these procedures makes the collision of the collision kind of process, and that will lead to the generation of the heat, and this heat will make the mercury to get vaporized. Now, during this procedure, because of the collision and the particles are moving from some through the positive pole and some to the negative pole, you will get a glow kind of discharge, which is actually the production of the UVR. Okay, so this glow will give you the UV rays, but this whole process takes actually 5 minutes to give the maximum output. To make sure, when you are using the lamp for the treatment purpose or for the dosage calculation, you should start the lamp earlier, before 5 minutes, to get the actual output of that particular lamp. Let me tell you, there is one disadvantage of this kind of lamps, because we are using the quartz tube. That is actually the form of silica, but as and when the heat is produced inside the tube, there will be this silica will get converted into the another form of silica, which is known as tridymite. So we can say there is always the tridymite formation as and when you use the UV lamp more. So it will reduce the output after some time. So after 100 hours, we can say there is a reduction in the output. And after 1000 hours of usage of that UV lamp, you need to change the machine because now the output has too much reduced. Okay. So another one is chromar lamp. So what is chromar lamp? We can say it is a water cooled mercury vapor lamp. Otherwise, the production of the UV rays will remain same as that of the high pressure mercury vapor burner. But the advantage of chromar lamp is you can use, if you apply the suitable applicator to it, you can actually use to treat it for the sinus or any body cavity in contact with the tissue. And another advantage is it, you can see here there is a W, which is for the water circulation. So this tube is actually enclosed in the water jacket of the circulating water, and at the end there are fans to make that water cool. So the heat will not get generated. If at all it generates, it will get absorbed by the circulating water. So there are less chances of having any kind of burns with this kind of lamp. And now the third one is fluorescent tubes. What do you mean by that? So fluorescent tubes are that there inside the tube is there is a special coating of the phosphorus. Otherwise the production is again remain same as that with the high pressure mercury vapor lamp. But the problem with the high pressure mercury vapor lamp was that it along with the UV A and B, they were also sometimes emitting the shorter wavelength UV rays, which we are not actually requiring for the therapeutic purpose. So here with the special coating of the phosphor, we can actually get the longer UV rays. What this phosphor will do, it will absorb the shorter wavelength of UV rays and it will emit the longer wavelength of the UV rays. Along with the specialized phosphor which you are using, depending on that, they will emit either UVA or UVB. So you can design it along with the need. For example, for the treatment of psoriasis, we require treatment with UVA. So if you use that kind of phosphor coating in the fluorescent tube, so that will emit only UVA, and the treatment with this kind of UV rays for the psoriasis is known as PUVA. P stands for the psoralen. 8-methoxysoralen is the drug which is used for the treatment of psoriasis. So psoralen plus UVA in the fluorescent tubes, you can give the treatment to the patient of psoriasis, which is known as PUVA therapy. What all are the physiological effects of UVR? We can divide them into acute effects and chronic effects. So acute effects, if we consider it on the skin, the first is there is development of erythema, which is always occurring with the treatment of UVR. Why the erythema comes? Because of the release of histamine-like substances. And the more amount of histamine is being released, the sooner and faster, again with the higher intensity of erythema, you will get with the higher exposure of the UV rays. So there will be always the formation of erythema because of the histamine release. Then there is always the pigmentation occurs. This pigmentation will take time, at least of 2 days. Why this pigmentation comes? Because of the synthesis of the melanin, which will actually put the umbrella like structure. It is a kind of umbrella like structure which is present over the nucleus, and it will protect the cell from the UV rays. So there will be the development of the pigmentation. Then after that phase of pigmentation, there will be the thickening of the epidermis. So once this thickening takes place, you need to increase the dosage of UVR to get the better effect. And after that, once the increased thickness is there will be the phase of pilling, or you can say the desquamation, and again the resistance will get decreased. So again you need to decrease the dosage when the phase of pilling comes. Another effect of UV rays is the production of vitamin D, that we all know. And another effect is that can damage the DNA cell, immunosuppression, and if we talk about the eyes, that will be having the conjunctivitis. Chances of conjunctivitis are there with the more exposure of the UV rays. Okay, if we consider the chronic effects, as you all know that there are chances of the cancer. Skin cancer is more common with the UV exposure if one is getting more amount of exposure throughout their life. They are having increased risk of development of skin cancer. And another effect we can say is photoaging, or simply we can say the aging will come sooner. So for example, you have seen the farmers, right? Those who are working continuously under the sun in their farms. So at the age of 30, they are looking like 40 years or 50 years. Why? Because of the aging effects, which is the chronic effect of prolonged exposure of UVR. Now, what all are the therapeutic uses of UVR? There is many conditions, most of them are the skin conditions which can be treated with the help of UVR. Most commonly what we are using it for the vitamin D deficiency, to treat the psoriasis, vitiligo, dermatitis. Then we are using it for the chronic infections like wound. For that we are using the UV treatment, but because of the some tedious procedure and again the inassurity of getting the response, nowadays UVR treatment is not that much used. Why it is so tedious, that you will come to know once we discuss the dosage and the application of the treatment. What all are the indications of the UVR treatment? Acne. You can actually treat the acne with the help of UVR. You need to give E1 dose and E2 dose according to the area which is affected. For the psoriasis, we have three different regimens: Leeds regimen, Gokerman's regimen, PUA therapy. In Leeds and Gokerman, we need to give E0 dose for the psoriasis. For the PUA, the dosage is measured in joules per centimeter square. Again, you can treat vitiligo, dermatitis, alopecia, another kind of counter irritant effect you can use. You can also treat the infectious and non-infectious wound as well. If the wound is infectious, then you need to give the E4 dosage, but make sure that the UV exposure of E4 dose is not over the healthy skin. Okay. So whenever we are using UVR, we can we can take the trial for 6 to 8 weeks maximum for any of the condition. If you are not getting the response till the 8 weeks, then I would suggest you need to stop the treatment. Maximum you can wait for the 12 weeks. If at all, if you are not getting any kind of response from the treatment, then better you discontinue the treatment with the UVR and see for the any other alternative options. When not to give UV treatment, like what all are the contraindications of UVR? So if your patient is having already the presence of erythema because of the UVR, you are not supposed to give the UV treatment. If your patient is having photoallergy or any kind of recent skin grafts or any kind of allergic reactions because of that UV exposure, we are not supposed to give the UV treatment. Or if your patient is having already immunosuppressive condition, like any febrile illness is there, we are not supposed to give the treatment to that patient with the UVR. Okay, before applying the treatment with the UVR, we need to know what all are the dosage parameters for the UVR, right? So here the machine preparation itself will take a lot of time, because to decide the dosage it requires a lot of thing to know, because your dosage here depends on the quantity of the UVR that you have applied to the area and the skin type of a person. So what do we understand with the quantity of the UVR? First, the output of the lamp. As we discussed earlier, when the time passes, there is development of the tridymite formation in the lamp. So the lamp itself will reduce the output. So whatever lamp you are using, that is most important to be noted, and you should record it, which lamp you are using for the treatment as well as for the dosage calculation. Second thing, again, the output or the quantity of the UV rays will depend on the distance. Say for example, you have kept it for the 50 centimeter away from the body part, or you have kept it for the 100 centimeter away. So it matters a lot on what distance you have kept your lamp. Again, the angle. So the angle also will change the output or the rays that are being actually absorbed into the tissues, and the time. For prolonged period of time, for how much period of time you have applied the UV rays, that will also decide your quantity, and that will help you in the dosage calculation. So everything should be documented before you start the dosage calculation as well as before you start the treatment. And second thing is the skin type and the sensitivity. Coming to the skin sensitivity or the skin types, as you can see in the picture, moving from type 1 skin to the type 6, you can see the more UV sensitive skin type 1 to the more UV resistance type of skin, which is type 6. So what is type 1 skin? It always burns, never tense. Type 2 is always burns, slightly tense. Type 3 is sometimes burns, always tense. Type 4 is never burns, always tense. Type 4 is moderately pigmented skin, that you can say a brown skin, okay, which is always tense. And type 6 is heavily pigmented skin, which is you can say black skin, or those who are having like negroid type of skin, which is again always tense but never burns. Okay, so now you know, right, the quantity of UVR and the skin types matters a lot before you start the treatment. So we can say that everyone is having different reaction with the same dosage because their skin types are changed. So for each and every individual, we need to calculate the test dose before applying the treatment. Which kind of test dose? You can say it is the erythemal dose or even dose, or you can say it MED, minimal erythemal dose, or you can say minimal perceptible erythema, because it will be different for each and every individual. So before starting the treatment with the UVR, you need to calculate the dosage of UVR. It matters a lot because it will give you the reliable information which dosage or for what period of time you need to expose your patient to the particular dosage, right? So first thing you require before the calculation of the test dose is your even dose of the lamp itself. So how will you get it? See, whenever the company manufactures the UV lamp, they give a even dose. And how they have decided that even dose of the lamp or the machine? They have exposed the many of the people with the different skin type, and they are giving the average dose. Okay, this dose averagely works for all the individuals. They are giving average, but what you need to do is you need to find out the specific dosage for your patient. Say for example, if you are not having a particular dosage, then what you can do is, okay, so if you are not having even dose of the lamp by the company itself, guidelines in the low end reads are suggestive that the lamp, usually the mercury vapor lamp, works well from 30 seconds to the 90 seconds at the level of 50 centimeters. And for the thyroid tunnel, they are giving 4 to 5 minutes of exposure is considered as even dose for the patient at the level of 50 centimeter. See, these are the average guidelines that are being given in the book. Again, they are saying you need to calculate the specific dosage for your particular patient to give the treatment very well. So whenever you are not having even dose of the lamp or the tunnel, you can use these guidelines and you calculate on the basis of this the specific even dose for your particular patient. Okay, now what all are the areas that you can use for the UV dose calculation or calculation of the even dose? The guideline says that you need to select such an area that is less exposed to the UV rays. Say for example, you can use the flexor aspect of the forearm, inner aspect of the thigh. You can use the the abdominal area to calculate the even dose when you want to use the tunnel. So what you need to do is you just take a paper or the lint pad and you cut 5 different shaped holes in it, and you just put that particular paper and fix it over the selected area. Here for example, if we need to calculate the dosage, we are using the flexor aspect of the forearm. So I will fix that paper or the lint pad over the flexor aspect of the forearm, and I will apply the different time duration for each and every shape. Okay, so as you can see here, we have cut 5 different shapes like circle, a square, triangle, diamond and star shape. Okay, now what we will do is we will expose each and every area for different time duration to know what is actually the even dose of our patient, right? So say for example, I'm starting with 15 seconds over the circle, then I'll cover it again. I start again, I will expose the more 15 seconds to the square, so square will get 30 seconds, more 15 seconds to the triangle, so 45 seconds. I'll cover the proximal shape, and the later shapes are getting exposure. So star will get 1 minute and 15 seconds. So here you can see we are having the card. This is a sample card that you need to give the patient when you are calculating the test dose. So here, as you can see on the slide, the shapes applied at 11 a.m. today's the same day. Today in the morning, we have on the 11 o'clock we have applied the UV exposure. Now what you have to do is you just give a sample card having the same shape that you have cut in the paper or the lint pad, and you just tell the patient to put the tick mark. Whenever the redness comes, you just put a tick mark. So you give the the timings on the same day, in the noon 3 p.m., evening 7 p.m. and at night 11 p.m. and on the next day morning 7 a.m. and you call the patient on 11 a.m. next day. Say for example, today we have applied the test dose, then you call at 11 a.m. then you call the patient tomorrow morning same time 11 a.m. and what the patient has to do is whenever the patient find any kind of redness, he will notice and he will just put a tick mark, so we can know which is the even dose for this particular patient. Now this is for your explanation. What will happen when you have given the card today 11 a.m. right? We have just exposed the body part in the different shapes. So at 11 a.m. present day itself, you will not notice any kind of redness. See, here you are not supposed to confuse the patient how red it was. It was a cherry red, it was angry red, or it was just a slight pink. You just tell the patient whenever you find any kind of redness in any of the shape, you just put the tick mark. You do not confuse the patient with the the degree or the intensity of the redness. So for your explanation, 11 a.m. on the same day, there will be no redness, right? Because we have just applied the dosage. You can see the duration, different durations that we have exposed with the UVR. Circle we exposed for the 15 seconds, then square for the 30 seconds, triangle for the 45 seconds, diamond for 1 minute, and star for 1 minute and 15 seconds. So 11 a.m. today itself, there will be no erythema formation. So now your patient is at home, you have given the card and you have told the patient to look for the erythema formation at 3 p.m. in the afternoon. So at 3 p.m. what will happen? Your patient will notice that the star shape has turned into the slight red colored. So what he will do is, he will put the tick mark over the star shape in the 3 p.m. time of the same day. As you can see here, the star has changed in the color and there is a development of the erythema formation in the star shape that we exposed actually more time, like 1 minute and 15 seconds. So it is getting, the early erythema formation we can notice in the star shape. Okay, now in the evening again you told the patient to see for the 7 p.m. on the same day. So what your patient will notice that the star shape has erythema, and again it is, you can see that it is the changing more in red. And here again the starting of development of erythema you can notice over the diamond shape. So what your patient will do, he will just put a tick mark on the star shape and on the diamond shape, because it has now started appearing the red at the 7 p.m. in the evening. So you can notice that again here there is still no formation of any erythema in the circle, square or the triangle, but in the diamond and the star shape, which we exposed 1 minute and 1 minute and 15 seconds respectively, has changed into the formation of the erythema. Now again at night you told the patient to look for the erythema formation at 11 p.m. So your patient will notice diamond and star shape erythema is still there. We can notice it is again getting increased in the intensity of the redness, but your patient will see there is development of the redness in the triangle itself. So the patient will again put the tick mark on the triangle, diamond and the star shape. We can notice there is still no formation of the erythema over the circle and over the square, and again the diamond and star are getting the intensity of redness is getting higher in these two shapes, while the triangle is just has developed the erythema right now. Now your patient will see the erythema formation on the next day morning 7 a.m. What he will notice? He will notice that there is starting of formation of erythema over the square itself, and the rest of the shapes are having erythema. We can notice again it is getting increased in the intensity of the redness. So what your patient will do? He will put the tick mark over the square, triangle, diamond and star shape. Here we can see there is no erythema formation still there in the circle. So here morning 7 a.m. next day, your patient will notice there is development of formation of erythema over the square shape. Okay, now it is 11 a.m. on the next day. So you have called the patient, right? You come with the card, we'll see what is the erythema level. So on the 11 a.m. next day, the same time when you have called the patient, what you can see is your patient is having just fading of the erythema over the square shape. Again, the triangle, diamond and the star shape are getting redness intensity is still higher. Here you can notice the star shape is having very red appearance in the intensity. And what you notice is from the card itself, the patient will tell you in the morning 7 a.m. the square was having erythema, but right now it is like fading away. Okay, here is the card when the patient comes to you with this kind of card. So as we have discussed, you can see at 3 p.m. see at 11 a.m. we applied yesterday, at 3 p.m. there was no formation of any erythema over the circle, but you can notice at 3 p.m. the star shape is having erythemal formation. Again, in the evening 7 p.m. your patient have put mark on the diamond and star. Again at 11 p.m. at night yesterday itself, triangle, diamond and star shape was having erythema. Then 7 a.m. morning next day, your patient is putting the tick mark over the square, triangle, diamond and the star. But again on the 11 a.m. when you have called the patient with the card, there is, you know, the fading of the erythema from the square shape, but the remaining three shapes are having the erythema still there, that you can see also when the patient comes to you. And you can notice there is no erythema formation at all within this 24 hours in the circle. So from 11 a.m. yesterday till 11 a.m. today, within this 24 hours, if you calculate, the square shape has developed erythema after, you can say 12 hours, or say for example 15 hours, there is development of erythema and again it is disappearing first. So what is the even dose here? For us, it is the square. Even is which appears last and disappears first. I hope I am clear that the square shaped has appeared the erythema lastly. Okay, the last morning erythema was developed in the square and it was disappears first at the 11 a.m. same day itself. Okay, so here for that particular patient, our even dose becomes 30 seconds of exposure at the level of 50 centimeter is the even dose for your patient. Okay, here is the table which shows the degree of erythema. As you can see, E1, E2, E3 and E4. E1 is the hour which we have calculated we calculated from the test dose, that was last to appear and first to disappear. So you can see the approximate latent period is of 6 to 12 hours and it is just mild pink that we have seen, right? That square shaped. When we talk about E2, which comes within 6 hours, that you can see that we have noticed in the triangle. E3, we can say it comes within the 3 hours or more than that, but it will appear. And again, the intensity will be slightly higher than the pink. So that we can see in the diamond shape. And E4, which actually comes less than 2 hours, and it may sometimes forms the blister or the cherry red or angry red, we can say, and that we have seen in the star shape. I hope you are understanding what is E1, E2, E3 and E4. So E1 is the dose that when you actually find out from the given lamp dosage for the particular patient. How to progress the dosage of UVR? Considering that your lamp is the same, as I told you, if you change your lamp, you need to again decide the dosage. So your lamp is same, the distance you are keeping is same, your patient is wearing the same clothes and you are treating the same area. Considering all these factors remain same, then and then only you can progress the dosage. E0 here is the subarythmal dose. So when you are applying E0 dosage, you can increase that dosage by 12.5%. When you are giving E1, that you can increase by 25%. E2 dose can be increased by 50%. And E3 dose, you can actually increase it by 75%. Here, no need to increase in the E4 dose, because E4 we are not applying over the healthy skin. E4 dose we are applying for the wound or the infectious conditions, right? So there is no need to progress the E4 dosage. Otherwise, rest of the dosage you can increase. Again, remember, if the skin is getting peeled off after the thickening phase, you are again supposed to reduce the dosage at the same time. Many a times what happens, our patients keeps to the department for the treatment purpose because of the unavoidable circumstances. In that case, again, we need to do the procedure, like we need to document it. Okay, last session the patient has taken on what date, and after that last session, now after how many days your patient comes to you. So if your patient is not coming for the treatment up to 4 days from your last session, you can continue with the progressive dosage. But if your patient has skipped 5 to 7 days after the previous exposure, then you need to repeat the same dosage that you have given in the last session. If your patient is coming after 8 to 13 days, you need to give the dose which you have given the 4 treatment before this one. Okay, and for 14 to 20 days, if your patient is not coming, then you need to give the dosage of 8 treatment before this one. Again, for 21 to 27 days, you have to give the dosage which was given 12 treatment before. And if your patient is not coming for 28 days or more than that, so you need to again start with the original dose that you have given it for the first time, that is maybe your even dose or E2 dose. You need to start with the same dosage if your patient is coming after 28 days. Okay, so with this, I think we have completed with the theoretical aspects of the UVR. I hope you find this material very useful in better understanding of the UVR. Thank you.